My name is Luis Castillo. Most of you know me as Luigi Squeegee. I'm from the Bronx. Here's my story. I grew up on 152nd and Prospect and Kelly. So I grew up in a chaotic environment. And the poverty really got to me and got to my mind. It got me thinking at 9 years old. Where would this lead to? What would I become? Seeing the chaotic view from my window, because I was a kid that everybody knew from around my neighborhood that I would sit in the window. I asked my mother for $6 one time to go to Yankee Stadium. And she said to me, "What do you need $6 for?" I said, "Mom, I would like to go to Yankee Stadium to cherish and appreciate the knowledge I know about baseball, because I always loved baseball. For some reason, I used to have baseball cards. I didn't have toys. So I became a part of a family, Nick, called the Bleacher Creatures, that were African-American, Latino, Caucasian, Mexican. Didn't matter what nationality you were, I decided to go after my dream and become a Yankee bat boy. And I told my moms when I came back upstairs, I told my moms, you know, it's time for me to do what I got to do as a man and follow my dream as that kid that was sitting in the window, looking outside and seeing, wanted to be like everybody. I wanted to be different.
Congratulations.
Derek Jeter, the captain of the team, telling little old me from the Bronx that my name is going to change. He nicknamed me just like they nicknamed people in the neighborhoods and in the ghetto. And he said to me, "Your name is Squeegee."
I feel great. I feel like, I don't feel as a baseball player, but it feels great that from, I used to sit out there and I'm on the field now and they're cheering my name.
So now we little kids, you know, ambition and life. So I say, "Alex, let's go." We had bikes. We rode our bikes to Yankee Stadium. And back then, we didn't have no keychains to bikes or none of that. We just left the bike right there in front of Section 39, the bleachers, right field bleachers, where everybody went and the seats were $3. It was cheap. And me and Alex got in. And when we get into Yankee Stadium, my first game ever as a fan. I'm 13-year-old, no parents around. I felt free. Alex felt free. But Alex was more hood than I was. And that's my brother for life, you know what I mean? I cherish him. He went in there, you know, with that ghetto mentality. And when we sat in this lady's seat, we're not thinking of it, you know. We thinking we got a ticket. We could sit anywhere because it didn't say a specific seat on the ticket. So Alex sits in the seat, and here comes this lady with blonde hair. And she says to us, "Hey, you guys can't sit here." I said to her, "Why we cannot sit here in this seat? We had a ticket we bought in. 13 years old, we don't know rules and regulations. We outlaws right now at this point, you know?" So Alex never experienced that in life. He came out with profanity. Came out, you know, "Fuck this, fuck that," cursing at the lady. At the time, I don't know the lady's name, but I'm going to get into that point to tell you who she was. She had us kicked out Yankee Stadium. I didn't even get to see the first pitch or the first ending of the game. And I just paid $3 to get in with Alex. So now I'm looking at Alex like, damn, we really getting kicked out of Yankee Stadium for your behavior. And so we ride our bikes back to the block. We got kicked out by security. This is how powerful this woman was. We got kicked out by security. So now I'm coming back to my mom's neighborhood and she's like, "I gave you money. Why you not at the stadium?" I didn't know how to tell my mother at that time. So I said, "Mom, you know, after sitting in my room, the Yankee game is playing live on TV. My mother's watching the game with my pops in the living room. I'm there instead of being at the stadium that they just paid tickets for." I decided to confess to her, you know, my friend Alex, you know, used profanity and got us kicked out of the stadium. She thought, at that time, I thought I was going to get whooped. So my mom's did me a favor after that. And she gave me the opportunity to go back the next day. But now, I asked her for $6 and I went on my own. And I had in my mind, sitting in that room all night, looking at that Yankee game, I was going to go back and apologize to the lady, not knowing that I would see this lady again because it's 52,000 fans in the stadium at that time. So I went back, hopefully, to meet this lady. I went back, and God sent, the lady was there because she's a regular. Her name is Tina Lewis. And I will never forget her name because I went back that day, and the first person I went up to was her, not worrying about watching batting practice, none of that. And I said, Tina, I said, sorry, ma'am. I said, excuse me, ma'am. I want to apologize to you on my friend's behalf. So I hope you accept my apology because I'm a huge Yankee fan. I just want to watch a game. She said, you're nothing like your friend. And I would like to introduce you to some people.
Oh, what's good, man? How are you?
Chilling, man. Just, you know, here, you know, thinking about some things, some thoughts, man. Right. Remember the time I took you to Yankee Stadium? How was that feeling for you?
That's a priceless feeling, man. You know, because you grew up in the Bronx and you're a diehard Yankee no matter what. You know what I'm saying? So I was just honored and privileged that you was a part of them as a bad boy, knowing that you come from the same neighborhood as I come from. So that day you invited me to the stadium, you know what I'm saying? I enjoyed the game, obviously, but what was the best outcome of the whole night was you told me don't leave. You said, yo, stay here till after the game, man. You know, I want you to see the dugout. I want you to see the clubhouse and all that. So you walked us, me and my brother Marcus, you walked us through the clubhouse. You know what I'm saying? While you was doing the laundry for the uniforms, the hats, and putting the bats on their lockers and all that. Like, that was a real experience from a person that don't see it. You know what I mean? So it's like, you know, when you did that, I was like, wow, man. Like, I felt like I was a real Yankee. You know, like, because I put so many years in for the Yankees as a fan. I'm like, yeah, you know what I'm saying? So, like, whatever, we were at there. And then you was like, yo, you want to go chill in the dugout? And I was like, huh? So I was like, yeah, so wow, you know, I went to walk through the hallway, how they walk, you slap the thing. You know, I felt like a Yankee, be honest with you. Walked into the dugout, sat there, just chilling out there, you know what I mean, watching the whole situation, like, damn, I'm in a Yankee dugout. Then what funny was that I saw some paperwork that was there, I guess Joe Torre that day. So then, you know, I start fronting, you know what I'm saying? Like, I grabbed the paperwork, I'm like looking at Marcus, I'm like, yo. And then I stand up and I'm like, I start moving invisible players like I'm in Field of Dreams. That's how I felt. It's like a Field of Dreams situation. Yeah, you follow me? So I always want to thank you for that. That's a memory, yeah, that, yeah, I'm a diehard Yankee, man, but not too many people could walk that.
I remember seeing you on top of that dugout by yourself, and I was like, wow, he's just standing there taking it all in.
I was bugging. I felt like, yo, you know me. I thought I was Joe Torre. You know, I'm over here looking at Stoudemire, like, yo, you know, come on, bring him. I picked up the phone. I'm like, yeah, warm him up, you know, because it's just like a big kid, you know what I'm saying? Like, you let a kid into what he loved, and I love baseball, and I'm going to love the Yankees. You know what I'm saying? So I felt like I was a big kid that day. So that was just like an experience that was an experience I'll never forget. I really felt like I am a Yankee because you walked me through that walk. Yeah. Feel me? The locker room, the playroom, the refrigerator with all the super drinks, yeah. And you know, just being a Yankee. And I thank you for that, man. Like, that was an experience that, like I said, man, it's an experience that I will never forget. And it's one that I wish a lot of people could experience themselves, but they won't. You know what I mean?
Growing up in a household with a sister from a different father, being with my moms and my pops, you know, as the only child, and having five brothers and another sister from another marriage through my pop's side was kind of difficult being the baby. I was forced to grow up, you know, alone, different. I was mentally prepared to do things on my own. It's harsh realities, but at the end of the day, that's how it was supposed to be and meant to be, you know, in my eyes. That I was supposed to walk this journey alone.
And I love what you did, you know what I'm saying? Like, you made us, you brought that to us, you know what I'm saying? Like, you would bring the ball players around, You know what I'm saying? And you know, certain ball players that would come around and show that love. And that was important because, you know, we put our time and our money into our teams. And you know, we have middle class and even the lower class people, they'll still save up that dollar to go into that stadium and just to see their star player, just to get away from the world for 3 hours, to feel like, man, this is what I could have been or this is what I enjoyed. You know, you brought that to us. You know, the Ramiro Mendoza, the Ruben Sierras, you know what I'm saying? You know, even when we went to the locker room that day, we saw the A-Rods and the DJs and Derek Jeters, like, come on, that's real. You know what I mean? And they know what real Bronx dudes look like and what real Bronx people look like. So, a real Bronx, not the fans that come from Connecticut and say that they the Bronx. And you know what I'm saying? Like, because y'all buy all the tickets and we respect that because we need y'all to buy the tickets because we can't really afford it here. But, you know, the stadium is really walking distance. If he could pan in a minute, he would pan that way. The early 1900s, and you was riding your horse and carriage coming from Boston or the Bronx River that way, you have to make that right on Thurman Munson Way, which is 156th Street.
And where they can find that at, Gil?
That's only in the Bronx. You know, Thurman Munson Way, Google it, 156th Street. Nobody knows that one. That's trivia for Yankee Stadium. That's trivia right there.
Just remember who said it.
What's the original name of 156th Street right now since he died? Thurman Munson Way.
You're washing dirty underwears, you're cleaning spikes, you know, you're running errands, McDonald's runs.
McDonald's runs? Yeah. Guys are eating McDonald's in the middle of games?
Yeah. Tom Gordon used to eat McDonald's during the game, and Mariano Rivera, the all-time great.
Mo?
Yeah, in the third inning, he would eat chicken McNuggets.
In the third inning? Yeah. How does he pitch on chicken McNuggets?
It's a talent, I tell you. And he would chow down. He was a big, huge eater.
How many nuggets are we talking?
We're talking 10 nuggets.
And did he always, 10?
10 nuggets, but he would chow them down again in a second.
Did he get fries with that?
Yeah, fries. And Tom Gordon would eat 2 Big Macs and a Diet Coke.
The group of 80 guys out here, 100 guys that, you know, if they approve it, they like it, then it becomes part of the custom. I mean, there's stuff that's been going on for 10 years that's never died out.
A little acknowledgement, not anything big to show up the other team, but just a little, you know, nod to say what's up. You know, they respect us.
All the players and coaches may like the fan adoration, but as is often the case in New York, there is some controversy over just who likes it the most.
It's been going around that Bro just really gets into it a little bit, you know? He lets it go on and on and on, and you look over at him, he's even moving to their beat a little bit.
He sings his own name for a while. If you notice, they say his name more times than anyone else.
See, this has all started from a shortstop down there. He's a storyteller out there, and truth be told, if you guys listen over time and time again, you might hear Jeter's name repeated more than anybody else's.
The friendly war of words between teammates probably won't be resolved anytime soon, because the decibel level in the war zone is sure to rise with each Yankee game in the postseason.
First place Yankees! First place Yankees!
In New York, I'm Sonia Steptoe.
The Yankee bleacher creatures will have their work cut out for them this postseason. The club's playoff ticket demands force the creatures to be split up and spread around the stadium. So if the roll call is to continue, they may have to recruit some more voices to their ranks.
What makes me unique from other bat boys is my first day on the job. I guess I was special. First day on the job, Sports Center, top 10 plays. I make highlights. I didn't expect it. Chuck Knoblauch hits a foul ball. I dive off my stool. I make a diving catch, you know, off the stool. Just jump. It was a reaction. And the crowd goes crazy. My first, literally, April 10th, 1998, my first day on the job. Nobody knows my name. Nobody knows who I really am. So it was like an introduction to the baseball world in the big leagues.
He's set to the belt in the 1-1. Strikes foul outside of first. Then a nice diving stop by the ball boy near the tarpaulin, and he will give the ball to a kid in the stands. What a great play by the kid.
David Cone, I got a glove in my hand getting ready to go back down the right field line to throw with the right fielder. And he goes, hey, Squeegee, Luigi, grab a glove. And I like, got a glove in my hand. And he goes, okay, got a ball? He goes, we start throwing in the tunnel and the pipes were real low. We were throwing in front of a
security guard named Charlie Sobranski. He was an old-timer there, and he's watching this, and we threw about three tosses, and Coney goes, it's too low in here. Let's go on to the field. I'm like, oh, my God. You know, starters usually don't talk to anyone because they're so tense and worried about the game. And now Joe Torre, Don Zimmer, the team is, you know, getting loading into the dugout. And I'm right, Javier Vasquez is warming up with the Montreal Expos on the field, warm-up pitches to face us. And David Cohn and I are throwing to each other 10 tosses. And I'm like, please, God, in the back of my mind, do not throw a bad throw to David Cohn and get him hurt. So I launch one in and almost passes him. And he nonchalant makes it look like nothing. And he goes, we're done. He goes, thank you. And he gave me the ball, and I kept the ball in my back pocket, not knowing. I just wanted to keep the ball. I threw it with my idol during the game. All of a sudden, the last out of the game popped up to Scott Brosius. It's a perfect game. And I just, my first intentions were to run on the field, but I saw how emotionally drained he was. I ran and got the cooler from the bullpen, came back into the clubhouse and gave him a big hug. He signed my baseball. And a week later, he gave me a watch. It was an E-Bell watch with a brown box that said David Cohn's perfect game, 1999. And me and only Joe Lee got that. And I cherish it. I still have it to this day.
We true Yankees over here,
that's
bro.
Right. You know what I mean?
And I love it, man. And like I said, the experience, you know, the fact that Squeege is my dog, and the way they embraced him, you know, the stories he used to come home with, good and bad, you know what I'm saying? Like, we come and we hear all the stories, and they were beautiful, you know what I'm saying? And it's a shame that, you know, life moves on, but, you know, he has a memory that he let me experience for a lifetime. And we will always be connected with that, not only that we childhood buddies, but just with that connection alone.
So when I make the diving catch, after I make the play, I give the ball to a fan, and it's a girl. And I sit on the stool, and my boy Mike, who was the sign guy, says to me, hey, hey, and he's pointing his head, and I'm like, he's going crazy, my first day on the job. And he goes, you on air, you on live TV. I said, what are you talking about? He goes, Michael K just gave you a shout out, great pay by the ball boy. And that video clip is still played to this day on Yankee Classics when I was 15 years old, making a diving catch that made ESPN top 10 plays. So Bat Boys, I felt I took it to another level at that time. First day on the job, making a play. Now the players respect me. Chuck Knoblauch even gave me a glove because I had a ghetto beat up glove, man. I came in with a Rawlings Model $20 gloves with holes in it. And Knoblauch looks at me, he goes, after that diving catch, my brother, you deserve my glove with my name on it. And he gave it to me. He goes, damn, at least be proud of it. I was just starstruck that Knoblauch was giving me a glove at my locker. He came up to my locker and gave me a glove. So now I felt like I was a part of the family my first day at the job. And I guess that was separates me from other Bat Boys.
I'm a Yankee fan, and when I seen that kid, you know, bro, he gave me a lot of chills, man. You know, there's some kid that, you know, out of nowhere, just came out of nowhere from the streets, came to be a kid that, you know, is a legend, man. Because some kids in his place here, that grew up in his neighborhood, didn't have things like this kid has. This kid is down to earth, and you know, it's very good people, and something that, you know, to my heart, man. Guy is somebody that, you know, I love, I cherish, my man.
But my bless, bro.
It's all good. The guy is 110%. I seen that kid grow from a little kid to somebody that, wow, man. He amazed me, man. His mother, him. Being a Yankee, you know, just being in Yankee Stadium, look, I get goosebumps. The kid is, you know, something. It's a legend, man. And I told him always on Facebook, I bless what you do, man, the kids. And it comes from the heart, like I do here. I do everything here from the heart. I help the kids out, you know, do everything, paint the place up, make it look something that, you know, presentable. I've been raised here myself all my life. But I met this kid, man. This kid is somebody, you know, I hope that God always has, you know, him inside. Because he's a good kid, man. It's somebody to, you know, to look. I appreciate it, man. I appreciate a kid that, you know, at least I know that I seen somebody that grew up in this neighborhood that's down to earth, man.
The biggest influences in my life were Derek Jeter and David Cohn. As a child, in my childhood, I grew up, you know, respecting David Cohn and his craft. I wanted to be like him. As a 9-year-old to 15 to 16 playing summer league baseball out here in the Bronx, I always watched him as a kid pitching. And I always emulated him on TV, going outside and doing the same, copying his style of pitching. And I wanted to always be like him because he was my childhood idol, David Cohn. And in 1998, when I became a bat boy, my childhood dream became reality.
Buenas noches, mi nombre es Rubén Sierra y quiero hablarle un poquito sobre la historia de Luis Castillo, alias Squeegee. Muchacho que nacido y criado en el Bronx y fue, pues, como quien dice, compañero mío, pero a la misma vez fue bad boy de los Yankees de Nueva York. Y entonces, pues, tuvimos muchas anécdotas, compartimos mucho en el tiempo que estuve jugando para los Yankees. Hubieron varias anécdotas, muchas de ellas pues compartimos juntos, fuimos a la casa, él fue a la mía, siempre me acompañaba en diferentes ocasiones, también la Serie Mundial compartió conmigo allá en San Luis, donde un amigo mío de Chicago, que bien fanático mío, y él pues andaba en su, él tenía una van, entonces pues yo ponía la música que yo quería, porque como él era muy fanático mío, él me dejaba hacer en el carro lo que me daba la gana y yo ponía música. Y entonces vimos a los muchachos, a Derek Jeter y a otros más, caminando así por el sidewalk, y entonces yo oyeron la música y se quedaron mirando así y dijeron, ¿y qué hace Rubén Sierra ahí en esa van? Y yo dije, no, ese es mi amigo. Oye, esa música, wey, la música que a mí me gusta, la salsa. Y entonces todos se pusieron caminando como bailando la salsa en el sidewalk ahí caminando hacia el hotel. Y entonces, pues, nada, son buenas anécdotas que uno tiene de experiencia y cosas que ha pasado. A la misma vez, pues, Luis fue un hombre muy trabajador mientras estuvo con los Yankees. Siempre me tenía mis cosas ready y la de los demás peloteros. Además de que habían otros muchachos que también trabajaban en el clubhouse, pero él era, pues, más cabecilla, como dicen, que los otros, porque él ya tenía experiencia y sabía cómo hacer las cosas. Especialmente él era el que me organizaba a mí el locker y me lo tenía siempre ready, los spybrings brilladitos, mi ropa organizada donde tiene que ser. Y yo pues siempre estaba contento y eso. Pero la amistad de él y conmigo fue una cosa que llegó a otro extremo. Yo lo quería mucho, un hijo, y claro está, nos hemos mantenido hasta el sol de hoy con la misma amistad, con el mismo cariño y con el mismo amor. Pues ahora en esta otra etapa en la cual él está haciendo un libro donde él está relatando su vida desde su niñez hasta el momento, de todas las cosas que ha pasado y de todas las cosas que ha vivido, pues es una enseñanza para todas esas personas que vienen de barrios pobres, que no hay nada que no se pueda hacer si no tienen la voluntad, el deseo y el amor por las personas y por ti mismo. O sea, son muchas cosas en las cuales él pudo desarrollarse en un barrio donde se ve de todo. Pero sobre todas esas cosas, él supo coger el camino correcto donde él pudo pues llegar y lograr muchas cosas que otra gente no han logrado. Así que, pues de mi parte, yo le deseo suerte con su libro. Tiene mi cariño, mi apoyo. Siempre lo tengo en mi corazón, es mi hermano, mi hijo. Y nada, yo lo quiero mucho y yo espero que todo lo que él haya hecho sobre su carrera y sobre su vida en ese libro, pues que se lo pueda expresar de forma positiva a todas esas personas, a todos esos niños que vienen creciendo, para que ellos sean unos instrumentos de excelencia para el futuro. Le deseo lo mejor a Luigi, Luis Castillo, alias Squeegee, y espero que sea del agrado de todos ustedes y a la misma vez que sea un instrumento de seguridad y de muchas cosas buenas, para que sepan que en la vida se puede si se quiere. Muchas gracias.
My name is Romero Mendoza. I play for the Yankees. 6 years.
Mm-hmm. How many years in the big league?
6 years.
You don't play six years in the big leagues?
With Yankees.
With Yankees, yes.
And 2 in Boston.
And how many world championships you won?
I got 5, 2 minor leagues.
Wow, I didn't know that about the minor leagues.
You never ask.
I never ask. Wow, can you say what was the first time that you met me? When we first met?
Well, it's a long time.
I know. How long time? Don't say our age. We're not old. We're 21.
How long? You're 96.
No, 98. See?
98?
Yeah, I was a bad boy 98.
It's too long. You remember.
And did you know you was my first friend in the big leagues?
Good friends. I see all his family. It's like my brother. And I still your brother.
Thank you. I love you like a big brother. I remember all the time that you used to bother me in the clubhouse, not in a bad way, in a good way. Like go get socks for you or anything you need. And I know, you know, they're big names like Derek Jeter, Roger Clemens, and stuff like that, but that didn't mean nothing to me. My best friend at that time, and still is, was you, because you took the time out to talk to a bad boy. And, you know, when my father passed away in 99, you was there for me and my family. And that's something that to this day I cherish in my heart. And that's why I love your kids, your wife, and you, for what you always done for me since 1998 to now.
But this is a friend, us. This is supposed to be your friends.
And that's right.
You know?
I learned from you. Can you be honest? Did I throw good to you or no? During batting practice?
Not really.
Not really. I was better than the other bad boys. They threw lollipop. I threw line drive.
Yeah, you got stuff. You throw good.
And can you tell one time, do you remember, Chucha, when we went to my game in Katrona when I was pitching and you went to see me pitch?
Yeah.
Was I good or terrible?
So-so. It's so good.
I was trying to learn. I was trying to learn your sinker, but you're a professional, man.
You never learned the sinker.
You're not gonna tell your secret? Not to me. You won't tell your secret?
No. No, you throw good.
Only
you throw like 50.
You know what they call me in Spanish? Tira fly. You know what's that?
You hit the bat.
That's a fly ball pitcher.
The fly ball. Did you hit the bat?
I want to get to one part, Ramiro. Do you remember 2004 when you called me on the cell phone and I told you it was over and you said it ain't over till it's over? And you was on the Red Sox. And we had a deal, me and you, that I had to wash your car, and I still haven't washed your car. And I betted you a gift in return, and you guys won. And you said that you said it wasn't over till it was over, and you guys swept us, and we was leading the series 3-0. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I remember. That day, all the team got together. You got a meeting, and I don't know what happened, mm-hmm. but I feel in my heart mm-hmm. that day gonna change everything. Mm-hmm. Well, everything where I play, mm-hmm. I'm the winner.
That's right.
And I never got a confidence, you know.
And you guys made history. You guys broke the curse and won the World Series after beating the Yankees in the American League Championship Series.
Yes.
Do you remember that I went to the locker room when you guys were celebrating in Champaign and I went with the Yankee uniform and I gave you a big hug outside the locker room?
I remember that.
And I wanted to congratulate my friend. And I tell you something, I did miss you when you left the Yankees, and I didn't want you to leave, but I knew you have a family to support and everything, but I knew you was a good person, and everybody in the clubhouse, even Derek Jeter, everybody loved you, and you was a key part of the Yankee organization in those years that they won with you, Mike Stanton, Jeff Nelson, and Mariano Rivera. You guys were probably one of the best bullpens in Yankee dynasty years.
Yeah, this is where I come to the Yankees. I think it's the best thing all time. And I never forgot these guys. Mm-hmm. Everybody got in my heart.
I'm glad to know that I got a friend and a brother that is not only a brother to me, but is a world champion five times. I'm never, as long as I live, I'm always going to keep your name alive. I'm always going to, you know, talk good about you. Not just because what you've done for me, because I know you're a good guy. And plus, I visited your family in Panama. You took me. I never been out the country. You were the first person that did that for me. And, you know, I'm going to always be grateful to you for what you've done for me and my family. And now that you see that I got kids, I'm an old man now. No longer a bad boy, I'm a bad man.
Yeah, you got old man, you got a little belly.
That's eating a lot. I stopped smoking cigarettes because you used to tell me cigarette smoking bad for you is bad for you, man. And I stopped. And, you know, I'm glad I stopped because now I get to, you know, spend more time with my kids and hopefully in the near future, you know. But you always guided me right, and I will never forget you for that, Chucha.
That's good, man. You have to trust you, trust God.
Mm-hmm. Can I tell you something? I still could strike you out.
That's not going to happen. No, never.
Hey, hopefully one time you could come down, and that's all I want from you is to pitch to you and strike you out.
Don't worry. you go happening.
You say you're gonna hit a home run. I want to see that.
I go explode that ball.
One last thing, Chucha. What was your favorite food to eat that I used to bring to you at Yankee Stadium?
My favorite food, rice, beans, and meat.
Right before a game.
Before the game.
And that's why I love you, Chucha. You're the best to me, and I will always cherish you in my heart. And I need you to say one thing for me. I need you to say one thing. Who was the best bat boy ever?
You.
I love you for that, Chucha, man. Thank you so much. And now you're going to have to send me a sexy picture of you so I could put with this voice for you.
I got a sexy picture.
Wait, Chucha. Also, when you know, I want people to know that when you used to come around my neighborhood and Kelly and St. John, and all those kids who now are old, you know, and they have kids of their own, they still talk and remember that you used to come through here and you gave a lot of hope to a lot of kids around before Facebook, before Instagram, and you used to sign autographs outside, and people used to wait for your autograph when you used to come to my mom's house to eat. And I just want you to tell those kids that are listening and watching that you know that you still remember them and they always ask about you to me.
I never forgot your neighborhood. It's a lot of kids in their home. And I hope every kid got a go right. Stop, go the wrong, go. Everything had to take the good way, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Stop, go out with the bad people.
Mm-hmm.
Go the good way.
Those kids, they really look up to you, and they always ask me about you, Chucha. They always say that those autographs, they still have them. They show me to this day that they still have your boy. And that meant a lot that a Yankee player at that time, you know, with your World Series ring and you taking pictures with them, they appreciate that. And those kids, all of them now, they got jobs. They could have went the wrong route. And, you know, they did. Because of you, you inspired them that you came, you know, a millionaire. You know, that you came from poverty yourself and you made it somewhere. You fulfilled your dream and you came and shared that with others. And they appreciate that.
Well, I'm still hoping guys here. Mm-hmm. And when you need me, I got to talk to the kids, you know.
That's a beautiful thing. Yep. I love you, Ramiro. And God bless you and your family, okay?
I love you too, my nigga.
I love you, my nigga. Ramiro Mendoza was a close friend of mine still to this day. Was one of the biggest relief pitchers in Yankees dynasty years of the championship era. And he was one of my closest boys after, you know, every Yankee game, home game, he would say to me, "Yo, Squeegee, where we going today?" You know, right after the game when we were finished, I said, "Well, we could go play pool in my mom's neighborhood. There was a billiard on 152nd and Prospect called Robles." And I said, "We could go there. Nobody would bother you. You don't have to sign autographs all day and take pictures. You just be in your own world." And he said, "All right, Squeegee, anything for you. So let's just go have some fun." So when I would go take him, bring him to the neighborhood, we'd go to my mom's first, eat some food, because they always wanted to land food for my mom's. She would do the rice, beans, and chicken, and they loved it. And we would go down the block. It was nearly half a block away from my mom's, where she lived, the apartment. And we'd go in there and shoot some pool for like 2 hours, have a couple of drinks, just like gentlemen do, have a couple of drinks. But once the word got around, yo, the Yankee Ramiro Mendoza's there, people from all walks would come and fill up that spot, and the owner loved it. So I started doing business with the owner, you know what I mean? At the end of the day, we would get free drinks, whatever player I would come with, whoever I would bring. At the same time, we'd play for free pool, enjoy ourselves, and it would take the players' minds away from the actual game, because when you finish a game, you don't want to hear about yourself, what you did, what's going on,
what you did wrong, what you did right. They want to get away from that. They actually want to be, you know, us, human, regular, humble. So their escape was me. Mendoza told me that, you know, Ruben Sierra, Luis Soho, their sanity away from baseball was me. So coming to my neighborhood, because if you go to Manhattan, of course, the media, TMZ at the time wasn't available, but if they were, you know, they'll get caught up and, oh, you know, he was over here at 42nd. So in my neighborhood, they were never caught up with that. I would never tell anybody. So at the end of the day, it was low key, but people would spread rumors once they found out who was there. But it shied them away from the pressure of playing in New York. And I guess I played a little influential role to George Steinbrenner's dynasty World Series championship years.
Screechy, get the A-Rob money.
I appreciate you, my brother. It's my boy Raymond Baez here.
Absolutely.
You know, good friend of mine, saw me grow up in the neighborhood. And when I was a bat boy bringing players around this neighborhood, and he used to witness and see that. I actually gave him tickets to a big game against the Red Sox at the old Yankee Stadium, and it was VIP seats. I'll let him tell you the story so you get a little bit more of it.
Right. It's my boy Luigi, my brother, another mother. I enjoy those times. Back in the days, I used to brag about it. I used to go and say, hey, my tickets, I pick him up at the family VIP players' gate. And usually, there's a name that you got to give at the gate saying, who's the player that's giving you the tickets that my brother used to get for me all the time? I enjoy those days. Beautiful weather, always Yankees and Red Sox. Impossible tickets to get.
That's right.
But I always get them from him. Appreciate him very much because I'm a baseball fan. I'm a Red Sox fan. So it's
okay.
So yeah, I have a little story. I remember one day, my brother hooked me up again. And I'm sitting down, and the first thing I look to my left is I'm sitting next to Joey Girardi. And he always check up on me, like, from the dugout, like, hey, how you doing? I say, Luigi, what are you doing, brother? I'm sitting next to Joey Girardi. He goes, like, nah. I'm like, yeah, every time there's three outs, people stand up and get pictures and everything. He goes, like, put him on the phone. I'm like, you're kidding me, right? He got security on his ass. Put him on the phone. I was scared. I grabbed my phone and said, excuse me, sir, I got Luigi. He got crazy. Oh, give me the phone, Luigi, how you doing? Then I spent like 2 minutes talking. After that, he said, anything you want, I will do now. You want a picture, you want me to sign in it. I will never forget that, because today he's the Yankees manager.
That's right.
And a very good one. So I know how close they are, and there's so many memories that I will never forget. Thanks to you, brother. Thanks to you. You're the only person in the world that convinced me to send you flowers when the Yankees beat the Red Sox.
And when he sent me that, he sent me a bouquet. A
big one, yeah.
With different fruits and everything. And I remember my equipment manager, Rob Cacuzza, said, who the hell sends a bat boy a bouquet? Because only players get that. And my brother here sent me one, and I appreciate that.
Sure.
Because that, you know, that is gratitude and it's real when you look out for one another.
Sure. Always. For life.
Thank you, Bubba. Derek Jeter named me. That was like my introduction to open up the curtains and start my show. So, going onto that field where Babe Ruth, Lou Gehrig, Joe DiMaggio played on, and Yogi Berra, is like a dream come true for a kid that kept his passion and his dream to become that. I wanted to be a bat boy. I wanted to be a baseball player, but I made it through the bat boy route. And Derek Jeter's naming me and stamping me was an honor. Leading forward to 1999, my boy David Cohn, who I idolized, wanted to become. I started, you know, practicing with him and throwing during batting practice sessions in the stadium, in the old Yankee Stadium, not the new one. And I would emulate being like him, the leg kick. People even called me Little Coney because I knew how to impersonate him. And he took me as a father figure. He took me in as a father figure that he was. He took me in as a son. And he showed me the ropes of baseball and the knowledge of baseball, teaching me how to pitch. So I took that knowledge from him and being a baseball player, professional, which people don't even get. You know, you have to pay for these things now. I was getting it for free. So I was taking that knowledge and crafting it in my game, in summer leagues. So when I would be dominant, when I would play in the summer leagues around here in the Bronx, like Katrona, St. Mary's, people would tell me, oh, where you getting this knowledge from? Well, these players were taking their time during batting practice to show me, just like David Cohn, Derek Jeter, Chuck Knoblauch, Ramiro Mendoza, and Ruben Sierra. They would show me how to, their talents to me. At the end of the day, 1999 was a special moment for me. It's crazy how a kid from the ghetto can become someone when his idol allows him to come into this world and be different, in the sense of he's been 21 times close to a no-hitter, and never, not once, has he got it done. The day of July 18, 1999, your boy David Cohn achieved immortality. He became the third Yankee in Yankee history to pitch a perfect game in baseball history, and as the Yankees. What's up, Mike, man? Introduce yourself to everybody so they can know who's on the phone with me right now with Squeegee.
Michael Coleman, residing in Nashville, Tennessee, former Boston Red Sox and most of all former New York Yankee.
How many years in the major leagues did you play, Mike?
Oh, man, I got drafted out of high school in 94, made my big league debut in 97, and I retired in 2006.
That's what's up, big dog. I remember the first time meeting you, and when you was with the Yankees, and I was a bat boy at that time, and your locker was in the corner, and it was number 13, and I knew everybody called you. Everybody called you Big Mike. So I was kind of shy when I first went up to you, because you was a big boy too, man. And at the end of the day, I was like, man, this guy's flashy, man. And you know, he's always, let me tell you something, Mike was the number one flashiest player ever, and has style with it. It came, you know, not too many guys had that style. You know, they was old fashioned. Sorry for the, you know, the Scott Brosius and stuff like that. They were great ball players, but they didn't have style. You know what I'm saying? And I just wanted to know how you know, let people know, when we first interacted as a, you know, employee to employee.
Yeah. Man, I had a lot of practice being around former big leaguers on different teams, learning how to dress and pause and jury and all that stuff. But just part of the game. It's just something you get used to. Either you are that type of person or you're not.
That's right. That's right, big dog. And what's your, you know, a memory you have or anything you can say about me, Squeegee, being a bad boy and working for you under your tenure when you was with the Yankees?
Oh, man, all my time of playing, I've been the best one I've ever been around. whatever you needed was done. If you knew it was done, you never think twice about it.
Thank you, big dog. You know, let me tell you something, man. You was always there for us. You was a great tipper. I'm gonna put it out there. You was a great tipper. You looked out for your people, and you know, we needed that kind of chemistry in the team. You know what I'm saying? We needed that relaxed, I'm gonna keep it real, that hood thing. You know what I mean? Because at the end of the day, you know the Yankees are serious, but we just needed that relaxing. And I want to put out there where the Latinos, African Americans, and the Caucasians, we all got along. 25 different characters got along. And that's hard to find nowadays.
I've been on several teams where it didn't mix well, but this was one group of guys that it was all about winning. and everything flowed like it was supposed to flow. I don't think Steinbrenner would have had it any other way.
What's one of your fondest memory taking the plate or even on defense, being a Yankee player at Yankee Stadium?
Oh, man, the phone call I got from Joe when Bernie's dad died, and he called me in the office and said, you're playing every day, you're about to tell us this. And I was nervous just standing there looking at him. that's when I got my opportunity to play every day.
I remember that, man.
Bernie, by far, between Bernie, Ken Griffey Jr., Deion Sanders, Bernie was one of the guys that David Justice,
that's what's up, brother, and that's what it's all about, you know, helping one another out. And that's why I'm glad staying in touch with you. I want you to tell people also what you do now that we were just speaking a little while ago, you know, with your kids, that you do with the kids out there in Nashville, Tennessee. You're winning championships as a coach, and I feel you should get an opportunity in the big leagues one day to coach, man.
That would be nice, man. I've been doing what I'm doing now for 10 years. I own a baseball training facility designed to help kids one-on-one and teach them what I learned in the big league plan. And I do have two travel teams, a 9U and an 11U team. The 11U team will travel all over the United States playing, and I will be back in Disney again this year trying to win that world championship, that wide world of sports this year with my 11-year group. So
that's what's up, brother.
It's what I love to do.
I applaud you, man, and that's what I'm trying to send this message out to these kids, man, that who you rather learn from than someone that had the profession and learned the profession in the big leagues and is teaching it now to the kids, teaching all the tools they need to know to become a major leaguer, hopefully one day. You know what I mean? I want you to give a shout out that I saw, and I follow you because you're a good friend of mine, and I appreciate everything you've done for me, not just now, before. Betts from Boston.
Mookie. Yeah, that's my man. He's been training with me for a few years now, and he's doing his thing right now. And somebody's gonna have to open up the wallet.
Yeah, that's right. Mookie Betts, Squeegee's a fan. I'm just letting you know. Tell Mookie that former Yankee bat boy is a fan.
my 11 year group has got the opportunity and my family to be around him on a personal level, not just baseball, but he's doing his thing right now.
That's right. We wish him many blessings, because that's good to see a youth doing good in the big leagues, and there's hope for everybody out there.
You got that right. So I always hope, put in the work, he'll come back around to you.
Thank you, Mike, man. I appreciate you, brother, for your time.
Anytime.
I got you, big dog. Mikey Coleman, I appreciate you, my brother. And it was a pleasure working for you. And a pleasure still being your friend, my brother. Enjoy your day, baby.
You got that right, man.
In the ninth inning, this guy throws 27 up, which Michael Kay's mentioned to this day. 27 down, baseball immortality, a perfect game. He's been close 21 times and never got it done. And he considers me his good luck charm, which he's mentioned to this day from 1999. Every live broadcast, Yankees, David Cone mentions Luigi Squeegee was the one that warmed him up during the rain delay and kept his arm warm for that perfect game.
Best boy ever.
Stadium with my man Squeegee, the guy who I played catch with in the middle of my perfect game. Never forget it. It's my man Squeegee.
Thank you, Coney. Thanks, Coney.
Doing two jobs at once. Delivering baseballs to an umpire and collecting bats. So I had no breaks. Usually there's three bat boys on one home side and on one visiting side. And usually on a game day, since it's a 1 o'clock game, bat boys basically, you know, if you had seniority, you could do whatever you want.
Hi, this is Ray Negron of the New York Yankees. The greatest job I ever had in baseball was that of being the Yankee bat boy. Being around the guys like Thurman Munson, Reggie Jackson, Lou Piniella, Bobby Mercer. I mean, the greatest time of my life. It was a glorious time. And the bat boy era never ends. It's an important job. And Luis Castillo, decades later, would be the Yankee bat boy during the David Cone, Derek Jeter era. And he lived it. He lived it to the max. He enjoyed it. He was a part of that history. He was a part of the fact that David Cone threw a perfect game, and it would not have happened had Luis Castillo not have warmed him up that day. He needed someone to throw to. Luis Squeegee Castillo was there. He did it, and it would not have happened without him. Luis Castillo, hey, man, you're an inspiration to all kids of the Bronx.
Here to rep my boy Luigi Squeegee, number one bat boy, Yankees, all day. You know, I'm a Met fan, but, you know, I like the Yankees. You know that. But, yeah, we man the block, man. You know what I'm saying? Back, Longwood, all that.
I used to bring players such as Romero Mendoza, Ruben Sierra, Luis Soho to play basketball, dominoes, play pool in the neighborhood lounges, just to interact with the neighborhood that I grew up in, Kelly and St. John's.
But he always was cool kid, always a little bro right now. So as our relationship went further.
And, you know, now, from fast forwarding from back then, I no longer now being overlooked. Now I'm bringing what was negative, bringing something positive. And I guess I was changing people's minds that were always being bullies and stuff like that towards me.
It was one memory when he took me, you know, to Yankee Stadium to meet El Duque, you know, one of my favorite players. You know, of course he's Cuban, I'm Cuban, you know. I rock hard with my Cubans. And that was like a special time where, you know what I'm saying, we met each other. Y dice, ¿cómo está? Oye, hermano, Cuba, siempre. So we had that little short conversation where he gave me love, man. You know, I kicked it with him. Luigi was there. He was the reason, you know, I got to meet him. And even Gita and all of them, you know what I'm saying? We go back. So, yeah, Luigi, I mean, it's my little bro. What can I say? You know what I'm saying? He deserves a lot of things in the game. He went through his ups and downs, of course. You know, unfortunate situations. You know, I hope the Yankees could, you know, bring him back to the organization. He's definitely needed, and he's respected to this day. All the players love him. You know, it's just the politics side that he, you know, I guess there's a little confusion in there. But we'd like to see that again, man. He's been a Yankee fan. He could be mad at them and all that, but he's a true Yankee fan and, you know, at heart for life. So this your boy Cuban Link signing out. A story of my boy Luigi Squeegee.
I never looked at him as a Yankee bat boy or a big celebrity, you know what I'm saying? He was my bro, you know what I mean? I always introduce him, you know, like when I bring him to my block, oh, this is my boy Luigi, you know what I'm saying? I never introduced him as a bat boy. If he was known as a bat boy, that's because he put the word out, you know? And Mendoza, he almost ended his career playing basketball with us, man. And I appreciate it, you know? It's just the feeling having a millionaire playing ball with a kid from the hood, the streets.
We right here at Knockout. This is where he gets his haircut, Knockout, Javier. Knockouts on Castle Hill, 1189 Castle Hill. Come over here, you get your cuts, look fresh.
The love and just him showing us love comes. Anytime he comes down here to New York, he calls my brother calls me. We go pick him up, him, Sierra, and we ride, we just chill.
Luigi's now, you know, been coming to my barbershop for a couple of years. He's married to my cousin. He was the former Yankee bat boy.
Baseball, this generation is not gonna experience what me growing up as a baseball fan experienced, like real rivalries, like, you know, and it's sick, it was sick. I had much fun with my bro.
Real good guy, you know, it's an honor basically to cut somebody's hair like this because he's a Latino from the Bronx, and he's basically worked for the Yankee organization, one of the biggest organizations around sports, not only baseball. And for him to do what he did for them and stuff like that as a bat boy, it's an honor to basically have him sit on my chair. But Luigi shows love everywhere he goes, wherever he does, it's just Luigi.
One time we went to the game, and I remember it was Ken Griffey's last game in New York, you know, when he was with Seattle. So he put, you know, he took us to the stadium, man. We had a good time. Front seats, basically like a little kid, man. You know, and I've been to Yankee Stadium since young. But just that day, man, it was just something special, man, because it was Ken Griffey's last day there with Seattle. And then Luigi was like, yo, after this, we're going to the locker room, which I didn't believe. Because being there a million times, never seen the locker room, not even to even sit down in the in the bleachers, like, you know, in the seats, in the dugout, I mean. And it was fun, man, because after the game, you know, I was with a friend of mine, Carlos, and he comes and say, yo, come on, we're going to the dugout. We went to the dugout, after the dugout, straight to the locker room. Once I get there, I'm looking at these players, man, I'm like a little kid. No matter how old I was at the time, man, I was like a little kid. Just seeing David Combs there, Torrey was there, you know. It was a couple of guys, you know. You telling me about Derek Jeter's Oreo cookies. Remember that? I tried to get one, you told me no. Because Derek Jeter, don't touch his Oreo cookies, man.
He's like a kid.
You know, he was like a little kid.
And just seeing then, all of that, the food that was there, beers or soda, like, you know, they had it made, and I just always wanted to share that with the people that, you know, were close to me, and that, to me, I cherish a lot, because at the end of the day, that's something that, you know, is now, it's like a memorial, you know,
right.
It's there, but that's where we step ground in, you
absolutely
know? That's history,
yeah,
brother.
Now it's history, and I gotta appreciate and thank you for all of it, because me being young and going to these games and going to the stadium, you made it happen for me. You know what I'm saying? Getting me autographed balls, you know what I'm saying? Like, it was hard for me to even catch a ball. For all the years that I went to Yankee Stadium with a glove, I couldn't ever catch a ball. And I'm telling Luigi, yo, man, I need a pair of cleats, man. Please, man. And he was like, let me see what I could do, you know, at the end of the year. And I was like, I would really appreciate it if I could get a pair of cleats. So I said, let me try them on just to see if they fit. So I tried one on and they fit. And it was like, damn, man, like, can I keep these, man? And Luigi's like, nah, you can't touch none of that. And it was crazy because at the end of the year, after the World Series, I got a call from who else? Luigi, man. And he calls me, I'm celebrating, I'm jumping, I'm about to go to the stadium to celebrate because that's what I used to do, you know, every time we win. And he tells me, yo, I got a surprise for you, man, I got a gift. And the first thing I see, man, he comes with these. Derek Jeter's official. If you see, they still got dirt. I don't touch them. This is like, this is a blessing, bro. Jeter sent these because I told him that you're a big fan of his. And it's funny because the reason why I got these was because I gave Luigi this picture. And as you see, this is the picture which I'm in the locker room with the bat. You see me right next to Jeter's, you can see it. So I guess he showed this to Jeter. And Jeter was like, you know what, man, he looked like he's a fan for real. So once the season is over, I'm going to give him a pair of cleats. And he ended up giving me the, after the World Series, man, which we won. So it's more like appreciated, but only because of this dude, man. Remember that?
His own little cubby.
The whole thing, man. But it was just like, he made dreams come true for a lot of guys. Either he was young or my age at 20, 22, 23. He made dreams come true, man, and that's what you did. Because, you know, what you did, a lot of people don't do, man, and you showed us love, bro. You know, and you fulfilled my dreams, bro, because I'm a Yankee, diehard, to the end. That's my team, BX all day. And like I said, man, you did it because of you, bro.
Luis Soho, who was a utility player at the time, but a veteran in the Yankees, he brought him to the neighborhood one time, to my mom's neighborhood, and people used to play basketball in the neighborhood. Puerto Rican, African American, everybody thought they were the next Michael Jordan. So, we had a little cup of coffee, little food at my house. Brought Luis Soho, so the neighborhood got a little excited. I was bringing a Yankee to the neighborhood because they always see this person on TV, never in physical form. So I brought Luis Soho to the neighborhood. He actually went one-on-one with this kid named Porky, who was the nicest in our neighborhood at defense. And I love you, Porky, my brother, but my man Luis Soho did put the one and twos on you. A Venezuelan, who's a baseball player, did an alley-oop on Porky, and the whole park went crazy. And that moment right there where unity was born in my neighborhood and where people started looking up to me, at the end of the day, is because I was bringing positivity to the neighborhood. Throughout all the negativity you were seeing, you know, of being in the ghetto, but at the end of the day, everybody would start calling me, yo, when you bringing the next person through, when this and that. And I just wanted to give that back to my community, share my dream with others.
Please call Section 39. And I was the one who helped secure the whole section and used to put bags and everything. And at one point we got lemonade copies and saved about 30 seats. And one day this kid comes with his cousin. Now, I didn't know who he was, so his cousin sat in our seats and I said to him, you can sit there. He goes, this is FM General, can I curse? I don't want to curse. Then he said, anyway, he said, this is General Mission, I can say whatever I want. Like, actually, I can. So he cursed me out, I got him thrown out. Then he felt bad, so he came back one day by himself with Sheriff Tom. And he comes back and apologized for his friend, and he's like, and then he told me he was a Don Mattingly fan. So I loved him for that. Brought me his card and stuff. We became friends after that. And then he said that his dream was to be a bad boy for the Yankees. I said, are you sure? He said, yes. So and then I said, I have a friend in the Yankees. I'm not going to name names. And I called him up and he said, tell him he's doing good at school. Have his teacher write a letter to the Yankees. Have him write a letter. letter to him, and then we'll see what we can do. So what happened is the teacher wrote a letter. I talked to the Yankees, and mind you, you got to wait for years. And then they called him off-season 1997 and said they were hired. So 1998, he became what he wanted to be. His dream came true. He was just a kid from the Bronx that I didn't even know from Jack. Just became a great Don Maverick fan. And then he was in my heart forever.
Luigi who?
Squeezy, I guess your experience with him, what you think about him, about his...
He ain't shit. That's what I'm trying to tell you, man. Luigi ain't shit. Yo, Luigi, how long we been on each other? I don't even know, man. This is 20 years. This is that long?
20 years.
Does I remember 20 years? I can't remember. No, no.
There's nothing I mean, the Yankees were very happy with him, as a matter of fact. The guy and Dan, in charge of an operation, I don't know who I say his name, it's not a big deal. Sonny Hyde was in charge of operation at that time. A big friend of the future. And then he hired him. So one day he came out there and thanked me and his mother for the great work. And we got the Liga.
When he was just a squeegee, he was just a little, he was a baby, he, you know, we had to carry him in our arms and shit. When he became a bad boy, you know, we had to bring him in a baby carriage. Oh, God, this is not good. We had to push him in a baby carriage so he can go to the dugout. That's how bad it was. Yeah, we know Luigi for a long time. He had talked to Tina about becoming a bat boy, and she opened the doors for him, and once those doors were open, he just banged it right through.
His dream was to play on the field with Houston, calling the roll call. He's the only bat boy in the world. We call this thing the roll call, and we would call the team, and then we would call him. So he was the greatest thing ever.
He spent a lot of years with the Yankees. You know, stuff happened that shouldn't have happened. He lost the game, but what he got out of it was an experience that will last a lifetime.
I'm so happy for his success, and I want to see him do good, and I love him forever.
Come a long way, man, from getting my job set to where you are now. Good to see you tonight, especially baseball players.
Yo, what up? It's your boy Prospect, man, from the legendary TS Tebra Squad crew, Big Pun Protege, BX, you know what it is, man. I want to give a big shout-out to the homie Squeegee, legendary Yankees bad boy. He was there in the 90s while they was doing their thing. All-around good dude, man. A kid from the Bronx who lived his dream. I'm happy for everything that's coming his way right now, man. So I just want to give a big shout-out to him and his project and wish him the best of luck, man. BX, you know what it is. Prospect. Signing off.
It's been a long time coming, but I know a change gonna come. Oh, yes it will.
Some peanuts and Cracker Jack. I don't care if I never get back. Let me root for the home team. If they don't win, it's a shame. For it's 1, 2, 3 strikes, you're out at the old ball game. When the score was just 2-2, Katie Casey knew what to do. Just to cheer up the boys she knew, she made the gang sing this song. Take me out to the ball game. Take me out with the crowd. Buy me some peanuts and crackers.